Okay, this one is number 243. It's called Darkie Town Rebellion, and it's by Carl Walker from 2001. And it is made out of cut paper and projection on a wall. So it's that, like, the black paper is cut out and then put on the wall. And then you can see down here, you've got these different colors on this screen, on this like overhead projector. I don't know if you guys remember overhead projectors, but like that's how I first started teaching, was on an overhead projector instead of a computer. So anyway, the colors move and change throughout the, like, when you go into this room. So the colors aren't just stagnant. So, but if you have looked at this, initially it should look pretty, but then it should also look extremely disturbing and upsetting. Carl Walker will burst into the contemporary art world during the late 1990s, and she's known for her drawings and films, but mostly for these signature life-size silhouettes that provide strong feelings about openly confronting America's painful history of slavery and racism. Darkie Town Rebellion provides a representative example of Walker's ability to create visually arresting images that question stereotypes of plantation life in the Old South. So, Walker's childhood has an important impact on her artistic career. She was born and raised in a comfortable middle-class home in Stockton, California, which is like an integrated community east of San Francisco. And as the chairman of the Department of Art at the University of Pacific, her father had an opportunity to expose Kara to the joys and beauty of art. But Kara had a content childhood suddenly changed when her father accepted a position as a director of the School of Art and Design in Georgia State University in Atlanta. The Walker family settled in Stone Mountain, a suburb outside of Atlanta. The move from Stockton to Stone Mountain is a dramatic change for a then 13-year-old Kara. The small, deep South town exposed her to the continuous legacy of Jim Crow customs. Even though that it, it's in the 1980s at that point, it still was endemic into that society. Stone Mountain is located near a monumental rock carving depicting Confederate President Jefferson Davis and his two greatest generals, Robert E. Lee and Thomas Stonewall Jackson. The area was also the birthplace of the modern Ku Klux Klan and the site of frequent Klan meetings. Living in Stone Mountain played an important role in shaping Walker's future art. After growing up in a tolerant California town, she now experienced the pain and confusion of being a marginalized teenager who was not fully accepted by either white or black students. The constant reminders that she didn't fit in led Walker to question racial attitudes and stereotypes. So Walker's experience with present-day prejudice prompted her to investigate the realities of slavery in the antebellum South, or in the post-war Civil War South. While earning degrees at Atlanta College of Art and the Rhode Island School of Design, she studied slave narratives, researched minstrel shows, and closely examined historical novels such as Harriet Beecher Stowe's Uncle Tom's Cabin and Margaret Mitchell's Gone with the Wind. Kara Walker's research convinced her that America had chosen to forget, or even worse, romanticize the terrible realities slavery inflicted on black slaves and their white masters. During the mid-1990s, Walker's search for an artistic form that would enable her to visually express the cruel realities of slavery is what she searched for. She found an engaging and revealing answer in an unexpected time and place, the 18th century French cut paper silhouettes. At that time, French artists would use paper profiles to capture the extravagant fashions worn by the aristocratic lords and ladies. The term silhouette commemorates the name of Étienne de Silhouette, the French finance minister who gained a well-deserved reputation for his penchant for making black profile cutouts. Walker discovered the silhouettes enabled her to create haunting images of stately plantation homes, petticoated Southern belles, and shackled and maimed slaves. She also discovered this cast of caricatures could be organized into a variety of evocative installations addressing higher charge issues of oppression, race, and gender. From Darkytown to Darkytown Rebellion suggests by Walker is that this installation is based on an actual historical event. In fact, it's an obscure painting by an anonymous 19th century American primitive artist, but that served as a source of inspiration, and that was called Darkytown. The work depicted a stereotypical images of well-dressed blacks enjoying an idyllic day on a rural Southern Carolina plantation. Intrigued by the painting, Walker decided to reinvent the image by removing the figures and placing them in a new and a much harsher reality. Walker's reimagined Darkytown Rebellion evokes an entirely new feeling. She replaced its innocent serenity with a new ominous sense of underlying turbulence that characterized plantation life. Walker's work includes over a dozen life-size black paper silhouettes affixed to a 37-foot wide museum display area. A careful inspection reveals a hoop-skirted plantation mistress, a black man standing upright despite a severed leg, a teenager holding what appears to be a colonial ship sail, and a black figure Walker identifies as a kind of rebel. Walker's procession of sharply drawn figures recalls the satirical caricatures of William Hogarth's Marriage a la Mode. Walker created Darkytown Rebellion to do more than just display a mix of historic fact and fiction. She also designed her installation to provide an immersive experience for museum viewers. Walker accomplished this by using overhead projectors to beam an array of colorful lights into the museum walls, ceiling, and floor. So when viewers step in front of the light source, they discover their own shadows have been projected onto Darkytown Rebellion's narrative. This forces the viewers to confront the connection between slavery's horrifying past and its continuing impact on America's racial attitudes. Noting the impact of her work, Walker observes, "It's interesting that as soon as you start telling the story of racism, you start reliving the story." Let's see if I got anything else to add to that. There is, like I said, the Broad is just amazing, and they've got another one that is actually way more disturbing than this one, because it shows powerful views of stereotypes of African Americans, like the Aunt Jemima logo. There's also ones of people being hanged, lynched. There's also lynching. There's also like suicide. There's also all these other things that talk about that are real, but don't really get talked about or shown in our history books. So anyway, Carl Walker is still a working artist, and like I said, you could see some of her work at the Broad. It's amazing.